In the meantime, the draft has started, so let's go to our Twitter handles and the draft itself, of course.
So the draft, as we can see, starting off ETC, second time he's been first banned, and a Tassadar ban. There definitely appears to be some good observation. Tassadar, Tyrael, and Valor appear to be the standard bans against Team Zealot these days, but Rag is first pick.
Yeah, I was just going to say, a slight priority shift from last week, two weeks ago, where, yes, Tassadar, ETC, Malph as well, usual suspects. Rag, he was a little bit higher than he is now. He's been relegated to first, second, or third pick, a few bans, and Tassadar has gone up. So Tassadar's rework so far has not diminished his strength. There was a lot of doomsayers, either about Tassadar's identity as a lore character or his strength. His auto attack was much maligned, but Archon, man, and the new armor talents, giving armor at 4 to
reducing it at 16.
Yeah, that's, I mean, that sounds pretty strong to me.
Sounds pretty effective. Sounds very Templar-esque. He does, like we said before, he feels very much Templar-esque now.
Yeah,
I am liking it. The storm feels, once you have that armor reduction, that storm feels really impactful.
Yeah, it's pretty insane. And it's great because it's supportive. He is a support, so it allows your teammates to do more damage. Anyway, that's neither here nor there. That's the draft will go on without our good friend Tassadar. No noble sacrifices from him except for playtime.
It's true. Mafurion and Tychus were the first picks by DNC. Now we're waiting for the second picks to come out of Zealot. They already have Rag. Tyrael and Valor are both open. They're usual suspects. Rhaegar and Valor. Tyrael so far being left.
Okay, so what would be the reasoning to skip Tyrael for now? Poyok, I guess. Poyok wanting Valor.
I guess so, yeah. And Grand Piquet loving Rhaegar because a lovely bit of bloodlust is pretty effective.
Zarya gets removed.
It's a little bit of a weird one. I would have preferred the Tyrael ban because focus.
They're removing Tassadar variants for Poyok's Valor empowerment.
I guess.
After Tassad, Zarya. After Zarya, it's Medivh. But in that order of efficacy.
Yeah, they could pick Medivh. It's not the worst thing. Not the best thing, but it's not the worst.
I guess Tychus's minigun is fairly bursty. Once he turns on minigun, you put Force of Will on the nearest target. That's a pretty good way of dealing with it.
DNC, what will we see? Are they going to try and deny any of those lovely picks away?
I do have the wrong team name for now in this particular draft screen, so apologies for that. Of course, we are following DNC here.
Yeah. And taking the time. Plus, I will say, that timer feels long when you're observing and you're playing. Oh my god, is that not a lot of time?
Yeah. And the draft is a big part of the play.
Yep, Falstad. And if they wanted to steal, like we said, Tyrael would be a decent, a usual suspect steal, but it's going to be a Muradin.
Double dwarf action from the skies, from the ground.
Indeed.
Wonder if we'll have a swimming dwarf at some point.
I don't know, how would that work?
I don't know.
Would it only be allowed to travel through the water bits of Blackheart?
We need a lot of water, like new water maps.
Basically a Warcraft 3 map where all the players have boats.
I'd like that. Warcraft 2 map.
Off. Warcraft 2, yeah.
Ahoy!
Okay, I can't remember which Warcraft it was. Wasn't there one where it was one race got something and the other race got oil?
Possibly Warcraft 1, I've never played it. Warcraft 2, both races had oil.
Okay.
And it could make juggernauts, destroyers, transport ships. That's pretty cool.
Very cool.
That third resource got lost in Warcraft 3.
Yeah. Oh, well. Warcraft 3 was very good.
Johanna makes sense here. Oh, hello.
We forgot about Kerrigan. It is Infernal Shrines. The double melee. Rag and Kerrigan together. There's an immense amount of shrine clear with Sulfurous Smash and the lovely Ravage.
Quad melee coming out of Team Zealots. Valor being the solo ranged here. 1.5 support and Rhaegar and Tyrael. Kerrigan. massive control over the Punisher Shrine.
For the people asking why there is no Valera, Valera has only been out for 1 week, give or take a day. So she's only been out, which a hero has to be out for 2 weeks before she is allowed in professional play. So and Arthas as the final pick.
It will take another week before she can get played.
Yes, which means she'll be available for the next EU. She won't be available for the NA Open.
Okay, so that's cup number three.
Yes.
In 2 weeks from now. Of course, today is cup number two, and we will have the semifinals and finals tomorrow of this cup.
Yeah.
Which is
cool. So yeah, the double tank lineup, the Meridian Arthas, that is an immense amount of front line, and they do have the Falstad for the anti-bloodlust engage.
Well, let's talk about how we expect engagements to go. Vala and Rag have a bit of poke. Rhaegar, Tyrael, and Kerrigan don't. Expect Tyrael to jump in with his Eldruin's Might, slow people, damage them a bit, do some shielding, and Tychus turns on his minigun. Kerrigan jumps in, tries to go for Falstad Malph for Tychus. Malph, maybe he has Ice Block, maybe he doesn't. Falstad maybe tries to Gust. We'll come down to Tyrael, Ethereal Angel's Sanctification timing. If they do not delete a target, DNC will turn around with Arthas, with Muradin, and start to collapse on Kerrigan. So Sanctification is super key. In fact, there are two key players here for Team Zealots, and it is Zarmany and Ethereal Angel. Vala, she will get largely ignored. We can have Muradin go for Vala, we can have Arthas go for Vala, it's not effective. By themselves, they can't kill her. There's 1.5 support. Vala is too mobile. Can Falstad just fly on her? Not really. So it is very much up to the Kerrigan Tyrael here. Vala will get ignored. Ragnaros, if he oversteps, sure, blast him down. But it's not the main theme here. And for DNC, it'll be all up to the positioning of Falstad, Malph, and Tychus, because they're going to be the main targets. Here on the left, Team Zealots in the blue, Shad on Ragnaros, Ethereal Angel, Tyrael, Poyok, Vala, Zarmany, Kerrigan, and Grand Paquette, Rhaegar.
On the right-hand side, Arty, Malfurion, Majin Nahi, Falstad, Talhuf, Arthas, Lorba on the Muradin, and Nasty is playing Tychus.
Lightning Bond finally coming out.
Yeah, finally being used on probably the best map for it, to be fair, so that is fine. And another even in death, which just gets crazy value, and we've all seen the Carbot animation. If you can get that final thing, you are RPing perfectly.
Hot Pursuit, Moonburn, Gathering Storm, Block, Third Wind, Press the Advantage, the bonus range after minigun.
Yeah, pretty standard sounds from everyone. Nothing out of the ordinary at all. Gathering Storm sometimes can be transferred for Season Marksman, sorry. Completely wrong stacking talent. But instead going for a little bit of ability power, because you already have Tychus for the auto attacks, and like we said, Rhaegar's level 1 talent can be swapped out pretty consistently.
Very docile top lane here. Kerrigan tries to see if she can do some damage. This is all about doing damage on Arthas, not killing him.
Yep.
That's pretty much not in the cards with this. They don't have enough kill pressure on him.
Yeah, you want to force him to burn out his mana so that he won't have enough healing in the actual objective fights. He will clear this up quite nicely. And with Frostmourne Hungers and the Globe, he's going to stay at full mana. Nicely done by Talhuf. He loses tower ammo, but overall, not the worst there.
Lauer. Very good Meridian player. A lot of these members are very known here on the ladder in Europe. They play a lot. Ouch, Zarmany misses the combo. Need to hit that Impaling Blades under yourself on melee targets. You can use Alt-W to self-cast. Will Lauer get a Ethereal? Yes.
Nice. Yeah, nicely done. The Even of Death, though, will do the damage, but that will heal up quite quickly because Meridian did pick Third Wind.
Oh my god, Shad going down here to Talhuf in a 1v1. Ice doused the fire of Ragnaros' enthusiasm. And that's a level 4 here for DNC. So they can start on that Punisher.
Apparently 1,000 degree hammer loses to -1,000 degree sword.
Yeah.
Naughty. Helping out here, like we said, we already said he has Moonburn, so he's able to help this out very nicely. An extra 75% damage to minions, mercenaries, and monsters, which includes the skeletons here. And dropping an innovate onto Muradin, who's dropping quite a few of his Ws here to just do some good AoE damage. And Talhuf, positioning himself along with Lorba to just continue to harass and deny. Falstad can fly up, and he should, because Kerrigan is already on her way.
Lauber misses the Stormbolt. Grand Paquette could have maybe been in trouble there, as could have been a follow-up Frozen Tempest there. Hold on that thought. Talouf getting the Howling Blast on Vala, bursting her down. Kerrigan will follow. The power spike of level 10 is, of course, very far away for Team Zealots. There is no sanctification, there's no cleanse. So any lockdown on the squishy will mean instant death.
This is so far the best we've seen any team do against Team Zealots for the moment. Like you said, they empower themselves a lot a little bit later on into the game. So we'll see how well they can survive.
It's always nice to be ahead against the team that is the favorite. But as a famous sportsman once said in golf, the lead does not matter. As long as the more experienced team keeps its cool and knows how to turn it around, that will be the most likely outcome, despite the advantage here for DNC.
That kicked out of Molten Core there. Tyrael stunned by the Immortal, and he does die. Goes immediately to try and get as many heroes as possible. Gets two Lorba, drops so low, and they're actually able to grab Arthas here and clear out the Immortal, keeping their fort alive. So one hero for one and saving that fort. Overall, very decent value here by Zealot.
Yeah, not a bad result at all. It looked worse for them, but the combo by Zharmony was too good. Got double combo there. And Tyrael's tactical death, actually splitting the team of DNC like the sea before Moses. And there we go. It could have been worse, actually, for DNC. Many members very red.
Yeah, it was, could have been, like you said, could have been worse. But overall, them getting the objective alone is already good for them. They just need to survive through this. Falstad, with the boomerang, able to clear lanes even quicker now and get a little bit of poke potential. Doesn't want to go down and try to contest this mercenary camp because he's one very outnumbered. Two, a Pharaoh Angel is positioned to try and trap him.
Yep. Nimbus Cloud Ethereal Angel streaking across the map to different lanes. Now, the key for teams here before the Punisher starts is to set up the mercenary camps to provide either a distraction or a real threat to deal some real damage. Now, so far it looks like Team Zealots is doing this faster. They were so good at this 2 weeks ago as well. They're getting camps, DNC is clearing them up. And that's not the order you want to do things. You want to be the one to get the camps. Hold that thought. Ooh, going for Grand Paquette. He's trying to get away. Lauber is going for him, but Tychus will fall to Kerrigan.
Yeah, Lauber in the background was doing a lot of damage here, but he's now with the numbers disadvantage. They are in full retreat. Now, Arty, though, is being focused. The extra speed from Rag on Tyrael allows them to rush through, and they're able to grab all three members. And this is more Zealot style. Able to just grab everything, put themselves in a great position. They're even able to pick up the mercenary camp that everyone sort of abandoned to go for kills. Ragnaros, 19 out of 30 stacks on his Q, 4 out of 15 stacks on his Catching Fire.
The lead does not matter. It's now been reversed. Team Zealots are more likely to hold on to this as they're about to reach level 10. Slightly before DNC, probably. Level 10 means Sanctification, Maelstrom. It could go Judgment again, but I will tell you that it's not likely here.
It was very much based on their comp last time. It was cool to see. Very unlikely to happen again. For now, Zealot in full control, 26-5 on this objective. And they, all the bees had, though, Arthur's soaking XP for his team. He's moving up to top lane, grabs a couple minions, and keeps that top lane pushing. Shad is, in fact, going to rotate up there to try and counter push that. And in such, missing one of the globes, so he doesn't get a. He misses out on. In fact, both globes. He missed out on two stacks for his
team. Misplayed!
Misplayed. Would have waited like 2 seconds, dude.
He did get level 10 for his team, which I guess.
They did get level
10.
It is going to be Sanctification. No Judgment, sad times. Maelstrom, Bloodlust, Sulfurous Smash, and Valor with the Strafe.
Punisher's gone already. Oh, nice glance. Gust. Yeah.
And that allows him to clear that up very nicely. Half the fort health gone overall. Not terrible.
If I'm not mistaken, the slow effect on minions and on heroes has also been exacerbated. The animation, that is, in this or the recent patch, that looked like a pretty hefty slow animation. Next time Mighty Gust happens, take a look at that. But anyway, it doesn't matter.
Keep an eye out. We'll keep an eye out for it. For now, Impaler's pushing into the mid lane, getting poked down a bit. But remember, Mafurin has that Moonbird, so he will be able to burst him down and Nasty helping out as well. But they do need to defend bot lane as well, as we are seeing Zealots putting some pressure onto that. They have everyone here. In the meantime, Arthas is still pushing top lane.
This is kind of a problem. I don't think it's worth it or good. Well, he's going to get the Ford eventually, but it will take him another 40 seconds because the minion wave is disappearing. 30-40 seconds. Yeah. Actually, you know, it's working out.
Yep, his minion wave has arrived. Arthur's still going, but in the meantime, once again, bot lane still being pushed. Nathero coming in aggressively, zoning out the defense here. So this fort will die here. But in the meantime, Tychus has been soaking mid lane too. So keeping themselves even in XP, but they are going to lose the structure. But actually, Arthur's will get this. This will even up.
Yeah, this was a super heads-up play, actually, by DNC. I thought they'll be in more trouble at the bottom. Any misstep could have meant that it would spiral wildly out of control for them. Team Zealots would pounce, turn on Bloodlust, sweeping grass, impaling blades, but they managed to get value here. Tychus, more often in mid lane than one of the members of Team Zealots, fort for a fort. Good moves by DNC, very impressed.
Yeah, they're still even on talents, even though mid fort is very low, they still had Gust by the time the rotation came back if they wanted to try and disengage it. So mid fort is vulnerable. And right now, though, this Punisher not going to be in the best place for DNC due to the fact that if Zealots are able to get this, it's going to be going on to tier 2s. But it is still very early in the game, which means going for a tier 2 at this stage is very risky because death timers are so short.
Very nice comeback here by DNC. They got the first 10 skeletons as well.
Yeah.
They're not going to get level 13 yet.
They're trying to soak it. You can see the minions, though, are a little bit pushed up, which is making it a little bit more difficult. Kerrigan getting rooted, so she wasn't able to get too many resets. Ooh, lovely boomerang. Norva and Thera Angel both trying to zone out the backline.
Oh, combo miss. Very important here.
Sanctification is dropped. Lorba trying to wade through it. The Sulfurous Smash has not been used. Zarmani getting chased all the way back. Sulfurous Smash doesn't stun anyone. It does a lot of damage. The Gust for the disengage, though. Marginehi is getting strafed. He's taking huge damage. He's able to retreat and stays himself, keeps himself alive. Athera Angel, though, trying to give his team a chance to re-engage. Taluf taking a lot of damage. Where's the stun? He's cleansed out of it, but the damage is still very high. Taluf already dropping low. There's the root. Can they finish off Athera? Even if they do, he's dead.
Taluf,
he's healed up. No! The Kerrigan coming in. Bloodlust is used. The Ice Block is used. And Zarmani getting focused down. Punished for your greediness, sir. But the Punisher goes over to Zealots.
Malfurion stepped that into Archangel's Wrath, took the damage, seemingly unnecessary, and it looks like they were both going to die. But Ice Block, dodge, stayed alive. Falstad came in. It was incredible, really. Yeah, Punisher went to Team Zealots and... But it's not going to do that much. Two towers, maybe.
That punishment, that was super cool fight. This is a really good team. Nasty getting shredded by a Sentinel there. But they're going to be able to kill the Punisher off very quickly here. And that's going to give them a good opportunity to not lose much more. However, mid-fort is almost guaranteed to die. Mighty Gust can be used here to try and defend it. But the rest of the team is not here because they're still busy defending the bottom lane.
Tetra, I can already say that from all the teams we've seen against Team Zealots this week and 2 weeks ago, DNC so far is doing the best.
Yes, this is really, really good.
Very exciting game here. Five-man invasion by Team Zealots, trying to take the Impaler, will succeed.
Yeah. Takes a lot of damage at their age, although going to be able to reach in that backfire, the power of Globes. In the meantime, speaking of Globes, Catching Fire is fully stacked for Shad, and as is Sulfurous Hungers. And he now has Resilient Flame as well. The sustainy build that we see for Ragnaros quite a lot. This fort, completely doomed. No way of protecting that. But going to be easy to clear out the means of mercenaries. They're not going to have too much issue with that. And that will also bring them a little bit closer to that lovely level 16.
Kerrigan jumping in. Following Murden's jump. Stormbolt will stop him. Sweeping Grass out of range. Not a wasted Mighty Gust. It was a good job.
Yep. Gets him out of there. Making sure that no one dies here. Falstad has that Flow Rider, so he's getting closer to just being able to spam out those Qs pretty damn quickly. Impalers still pushing the mid lane. We're seeing Martian move in to continue to work that down. With no objective on the map, this is good timing for this Mercenary Cap to be here. We're going to see it get cleared up quite quickly by DNC. They're positioning themselves very nicely, and this timing works very well for them. They're clearing without too much issue.
This shows experience. He's deliberately allowing the Impalers to kill as much of his own minion wave as possible to keep the minion wave on his side and to deny experience to Team Zealots. Look at that.
Yeah, very nice. Super cool. It's a lovely little move. Don't always have to kill the minions. Yeah, the push is nice, but look at this. The mid lane still has both towers up. You're not going to get any value from that without a big push, which you're not going to get by clearing a single minion wave.
Right. I mean, there's two things that minion waves gives you. Three things. Potential siege damage, vision, and experience. But if you're already getting the experience by just standing there and you don't need the time, that's one gone. So it's only about siege damage and vision. Okay, vision is good, but siege damage you won't get it. So it's basically vision against XP denial. And that's a choice you need to make. Many people don't make it, they just kill the minion wave when they see it. This is a good team, they make such decisions. Now, level 16 for both sides. Holy ground zoning out from one side, which makes it very easy for Kerrigan to do her combo, but she lost her combo.
Yeah, she lost her combo. She has to wait a little bit for that to come back. It's already back. Ravage, the minion, did die. So she is she has everything available now if she wants to go back in. The Odin has been popped. 26 to 15. Kerrigan still working it down, looking for an opportunity while Tyrael gets the zoning cleanse. It's used on Tanuf, who begins to wade forward. There's the sanctification already dropped. And Kerrigan getting some huge value. Lorma tanking through this, though. Gust is used into the corner, and as such, the brute does not land. The Thera Angel getting focused out in the background. Here's the Bloodlust focusing onto Lorma. The Thera Angel trying to drop the escape. The multi-core was used there. Tower goes Lorma, and Kerrigan going deep onto Artie. And the split was incredible. Zealots completely separating the team of DNC there, and as such, able to take the fight and the objective, and Nehi as well. Nasty very nearly going down. We will see Tulu still currently fighting Shad. Can't really do much about this.
It's not per se a good thing to die so much later than the rest of the team, if it is death that's in the cards for Arthas. For now, it's not. If he were to die, let's say, in 10 seconds due to delayed death, that would mean a persistent 4v5. Not ideal. But anyway, Taluf made it back.
Yeah, he baits it, takes a lot of damage. He's going to go down, taken out that extra giant Scorcher from the Ragnaros. Super effective in the damage. Tychus needs some good damage with the grenade. He has Titan grenade here for extra damage. Arty moving forward. Lorma trying to distract in the backline. Puts the Punisher off the core, but he is removed from the world. And as such, Zealots move on to the core, and that is going to be GG. And Zealots, game number one in this best of three series.
It's difficult to be critical of DNC. They played that fight not 100% perfectly, but they'll get away with it against 90% of the teams in Europe. Team Zealots, they played it too well. They just turn it around no matter what, no matter how the fight is going. Ragnaros was getting some pretty sick value. Pinpoint precision on the Sulfurous Smash. Yeah, all the way from across the mid fort, but he landed that on Falstad without setup. Very well done. Team Zealots, 1-0 lead. And it is a best of three, so we're going to see one more between these two. I'll show you guys the talents. Take a sprint screen if you like. Match it up to what every picture is, and you'll know the builds of these fantastic players.
Tomb of the Spider Queen, gonna be our second map in this series, and it's Ragnaros panned out straight away.
The funny thing is, there was very little talk by us and focus on him, of Ragnaros, because there was so much Kerrigan action going on.
Yep, Kerrigan is sort of a more heavy engager, but Rag was doing damage. He did his job.
No, but that's the thing, right? Whenever you have a Kerrigan on your team, I always say virtually, any hero can be picked and be put alongside or next to or behind Kerrigan. And it's the same with Illidan. You're going to get completely ignored. It's all about Kerrigan goes in, does she help to kill someone, or will she die instead? And many of the cases, it was exactly one of those. It was very often not the case that she didn't kill someone and actually got away. It was Sanctification who kept her alive by the skin of her teeth. So you put a Ragnaros with her, there's no focus on him. He can do whatever he wants. And he's pretty good in that scenario.
Very true. Kerrigan, very solid. Not being picked yet, though. Tomb of the Spider Queen, she can be picked. Decent lane-to-lane ganker. ETC was the first pick via Team Zealots, and they're going with Tychus. And once again, Grand Paqueta getting the Rhaegar.
2 years ago, it was all about ETC Taron the Kerrigan on Tomb of the Spider Queen. Very heavy emphasis on rotations and deletions of enemy heroes. But for now, Tomb of the Spider Queen is all about killing waves as fast as possible. And which seems weird. You're constantly passing each other like ships in the night. You meet S4 mid, you meet S4 top, that kind of thing. And yet there's no killing on each other. Because if you try and fail, your minion wave will be lost. You'll lose another minion wave top. It's very strange, but the way that the map works out, it's very important to get those gems, the waves, and there's pretty much no time to lose. So the killings are rare early.
Yeah, this is true. You'll maybe get a kill, especially with ETC or someone like that in the rotations top to bot, but like you said, it's very rare.
Jaina, man.
Yeah, that's a strange one. It's a good follow-up. for the ETC engage, especially if they went for a follow-up stunner after that.
I'm very surprised by Jane Van. We see, actually, in Pro Division as well, we may not fully realize the, or at least I don't, the exact conditions for her arrival. I suppose you could go Jaina Zeratul in final location, since all roles are already covered in ETC Tychus Rhaegar. But then, why Jaina specifically? Why not Zera?
Very true. Or why not both? Ring of Frost into Ring of Frost Void Prism.
Now, I'm just thinking, if you ban one of the two, why Jaina specifically? That means that she would still be good without Zera, they think.
Which Zera is probably a bit more independent and can be picked separately. Zulban,
that's what I thought.
Very solid. Yeah, makes sense. Zulban also makes a lot of sense. Solid solo laner, and even in the rotation, can just get a double skeletons pushing.
It's also because Johanna is so highly prioritized, right? They literally took Johanna after ETC only, which means we want to go for a long game. That's what Johanna does. She doesn't die, she doesn't kill. I know that's oversimplification, but she's not a flashy hero like Zeratul or ETC that gets stuff done. She draws out games, same as Tassadar. So they are looking to play the wave clear game here, DNC.
Yeah, Johanna is there to walk up to your face and have you do absolutely nothing about it. That is exactly what she's there for.
So which hero are they trying to carry to the late game with this idea?
Lunara has been very solid on this exact map from Fnatic and teams like that. Stacking her up for late game just gets insane value. Valor's still available, hasn't been picked or banned yet. Sylvanas and Leoric.
Okay, Sylvanas is someone who enables what we're talking about. Same as Tassadar, Johanna, Leoric, and Zul. So they're still on that route of enabling.
What are they empowering?
We still don't know that. Sylvanas is more of an early game hero than a late game hero.
It'll be fun. I'm interested.
It should probably be Lunara. Kel'Thas is not bad, but I don't think that you can just go for Kel'Thas now. I don't think
so. Blue. Depending on what they pick, if it was a double tank out of Zealots, wouldn't be the worst thing, like we said, because percentage damage is a lovely thing, but Lunara can take Giant Killer if she really wanted to.
I wonder if we go like Dahaka Zeratul here, or maybe Falstad Dahaka, or one of the
something global to try and counteract the push from Sylvanas. Point out once again that currently Leoric is the solo laner for DNC, whereas Zealots do not currently have one.
Oh, good point.
Maybe Tychus.
They might need Thrall.
Dahaka's good solo laner, but he's going to struggle a little bit against Leoric, and there's a Falstad.
Okay, so it is those two. It's not just about going from north to south. It's also just about Hearthstoning and then going back to lane. Because it's so important to be there at all times. Generally, the first team to level 4, and I know this is going to sound really stupid. It sounded different in my head. I'm going to say it anyway. The first team to 4 is the first team to 7, is the first team to pay, will be the first team to 10. That is very important. There was a stat a while ago. I don't know if it's still accurate. The first team to pay in has like over 60% chance to win. It gets you the towers, gets you level 10, gets you the second pay in. And it doesn't have to be that way. There's room for comebacks and mistakes. But early game, wave clear will be an important ingredient for getting that level 10 recipe. Is it Lunara now, Tetra?
Lunara is what I would lean towards. Because, like you said, the late game, her poison just scales really, really nicely. So she can get a lot of value. Other than that, maybe someone with a... I don't like Chromie. Not in this situation. She's kind of in the situation. There's cleanse available, but like we mentioned before, the slowing sands do counter the bloodlust. This is more a personal preference of I hate Chromie's face. And also Kit, and also everything about her.
I love her, but I don't see her as the hero that you carry to the late game.
Goodness, she's good all game. That's the point. Like she's better early game because she gets her talents earlier.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, she has a level 18 power spike. Let's just get to 18, boys. Chromie, you can temporal loop Rhaegar and try to burst him down.
Yeah, only person who can't be cleansed because you can't cleanse yourself.
But while doing that, while you set up temporal loop, you can get gusted, which means none of your abilities will go off because they get interrupted. Q has a wind up. Maybe your W will go off, depending on the gust timing. Also, there can be a stage dive power slide, which exposes you, and the Haka can just walk forward and start hurting you. I think it might be a Shifting Sands game, which means this is going to be a very slow game style attempt. And I actually forgot to remove my name. I swear to you, that was not intentional. Twitter handle was gone. My name was still there. Narcissism at its best. Red team here on the right side. DNC, it's Taluf, Lauber, Majin, Nehi, Nasty, and Arty. And on the left,
on the left hand side, it is Poik Shad, who really wants to outstrip his team. But there are Angel, Zabadi, and Grab Paqueta. And a pause. Which gives us time to talk about the talents. Hopelessness coming in for Leoric. Very standard talent a lot of the time here. This is a map where you'll sometimes see the Regen Globe talent that he can get. Yeah. But not in this case. Falstad with Season Marksman. Great on this map. It no longer has a cap limit. You can just get all those stacks and prog rock on ATC because globes are ease on this map.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, I like the Gathering Storm, but I think Seasoned is better almost every time. People generally don't like to eat the hammer stacks too much, whereas minions don't have much say in the matter. So it's easier to stack.
It's very true. And also, we should mention Chromie. Time Walker's Pursuit. It's the first time we've seen Chromie in an EU Open League game. It's appeared at the main HGC quite a few times via Chris and Fnatic, who immediately took responsibility and said, yeah, we invented this. Chris had nothing to do with it.
Triple advantages gives you ability power after you get a lot of globes, gives you a vision activatable, and also a mana regeneration extra. A pretty nice triple little combo.
Yep. And the vision especially is the bit I like a lot about that talent. A level 1 clairvoyance basically is a lovely talent. The fact it gives mana as well is just makes it a beautiful talent in my opinion.
Yeah, I do agree with that. I think it is probably the best.
Well, the rotations are very much helped by Chromie. I like that.
Yeah, I guess the W is not too bad. Condemn W gets some pretty good value. I wonder if she'll make the... No, you know, probably realistically it's going to be bronze talents. Yeah. It's just
standard build so far. And also the Hourglass just delaying the rotations quite a bit. Even harassing Athera Angel a little bit. Gets the bronze talents too. Little bits of poke here and there coming out from Team DNC.
Yeah, I would always go bronze talents against Double Warrior. You don't have to weave in auto attacks as Morales as Chromie. And Chromie without bronze talents doesn't have much of an auto attack. But pretty much in pro play, every damage matters. Everyone needs to do a bit of auto attacks. If you can do that from a far safer range, that is going to be a big advantage. And that's the case with bronze talents. And it gets really chunky. 300 to 500 damage is her auto attack after she uses a Q.
Yeah, it's most other heroes' abilities. It's just that Chromie's happened to half health you. Yep. Once again, waves continuing to be absolutely decimated. Rotations, not really any XP is being missed by Zealots here. The rotation is just slower. Simple as that. They're not missing anything, it's just happening later.
And that means that you're often going to be in a 4 versus 3, like here, because one person still has to soak the lane at the tower. It also means that the towers will run out of ammunition sooner or later.
Yeah. This is true. And right now, that was a little bit of rotation interrupt with that fight. Zealot very nicely clearing that. And as such, a little bit of XP is not actually going to be missed in mid lane. Lorba able to rotate quick enough because Zealot killed the minions so quickly that none of theirs died.
In the meantime, one footman will be lost here for Team Zealots. But I agree with you. That fight, it was a 3v4 willingly, but the power slide clipped two people, which meant they broke the rotational tempo of DNC, which pretty much sets them back. If they hadn't done that, these towers would be half ammunition. Now they've had the ability to regenerate back up to full here in the middle. So that's a really good job by Zealots. They have staved off some of that effect.
Yeah, and the CC potential from ETC is also just putting on a lot of pressure. And even with Chromie's poke, it's going okay for Zealots. Once again, more vision being got by that Time Walker's pursuit. But this isn't the worst situation for them.
ETC got pretty hurt by Bronze Talents. He's dropping low. It's dropping very low. Another Bronze Talents and the Q! And he dies.
That Bronze Talents, so much damage. Go for Shad this time, but Shad Barrel rolling far away doesn't get Grand Paqueta either. But once again, the damage is good. Chromie working out very nicely. And like you said, I pretty much agree with you at this point. Shifting Sands would not be bad for them at all.
Johanna died as well, I believe, in the mid lane.
Think so. Maybe.
And looking at the gem count, wait, did he lose gems? 57. No,
don't think so.
Okay,
but that kind of mutes their entire rotation here, because Johanna was the entire setup for Krobi's rotation in general, and as such, they've had to completely split their lane setup.
Ooh, imagine that he takes 50% unnecessary damage coming back before the minigun was entirely over.
Yeah, it hurts a bit. Slight mistake there. Nasty attempting to poke down Shad, but not getting anything. So rotation was attempted there by Zealots, but it was scouted out by the Time Walker's pursuit, and we were seeing the Oryk already playing safe enough, so he wasn't going to get caught out, as he has the hardened bones.
Yeah, he narrowly dodged the drag tongue. If he hadn't, he would have got power sliding and killed. Very important movement there. Hardened bones will help if you can get it off on time. Falstad paying 3 gems. Every little bit matters.
Oh, there are. Taking so much damage, getting focused, and
boom.
Popped again.
Chromie 2-0 ETC.
Yeah, this is, it's going well. The damage is good. Like you said, Bronze Talons is just a huge amount of poke.
Dragon's Eye, 25% more damage in the center. Some people will like to go for the cooldown reset on Dragon's Breath, but this one is the most potent. It will clear a wave entirely with Condemn, do massive damage. We do get that slowing sands. I call it shifting, it's slowing.
Yeah.
There's a bit of shifting too, but it's mostly
slowing. It's shifting. Shifting is what causes the slowing, we shall say.
Yeah, without the shifting, it would kind of just
Nasty
be normal.
Nasty decided to stand completely in the Mexican wave. Takes all the damage, but Arty able to heal that up very quickly. More poke coming out. Lovely bit of Dragon's Eye, able to do huge damage to those web weavers, prevent it from getting as much much worth as possible, because it does take down health.
ETC dropping low from Chromie.
Consistently.
I may have misjudged their ability to contribute on a wave clear map. Especially when it comes to killing those web weavers. It's kind of a single target Battlefield of Eternity
feeling. Is where she's been picked in most of the HGC matches she's been picked in. Just usually it's against Ahriel, who doesn't have cleanse.
Right.
Either way, web weavers finally cleared up except for top, which is very low. That will die just to its own ticking health.
And that's basically where this kind of composition excels from DNC. It's not dying. It's not killing, but it's generally not dying.
I mean, it's 2 kills to 1, and both of those kills have been on the tank, just via Chromie, basically, just getting a huge amount of CC.
Could have been a mistake.
Trying to do his job.
ETC underestimating her power a little bit, but nice defense on the Web Weavers. Pretty much none of the forge got damaged.
Yeah, so very nice defense. If they can get their own in, they currently have 79 gems, with 19 already turned in. They are very much ready to get them in if they can. In the meantime, though, gems slowly being collected by Team Zealots, looking for their second turn in, as they also hit level 10 first, thanks to killing off most of the towers. Oh, grab Paqueta. The damage.
Haha! Says Chromie. Nice slowing
sound. I
hate
you so much, Chromie. You are my nightmare.
There's like 57 Chromie fans here that are cheering every time she hits a skill shot.
I know. And it
Trixler is one of them.
Oh my god. Me and Trixler agree on a lot of things, Artanis being one of them. We very much disagree on Chromie. Good start onto Johanna here, getting focused down. She pops the iron skin, but it's very quickly burst down, and Chromie's attack does miss. And as such, Lorba getting focused down, but the blessed shields and the actual silence able to get him out of there. Two heroics dropped, but Johanna did live.
Wailing too. A lot of resources being drawn there to save Johanna. Leoric in the meantime did pay.
Stage dive.
Oh my god,
very, that was so cool.
Very important haunting wave out. Had he not, he would have died. There was no cleanse.
Yeah. Absolutely beautiful play. Beautiful play indeed. And the red team, DNC, finally got their turn in, and they still have a monumental amount of gems, so they want to try and get the chain turn-ins happening. Now the question is, how much value can they get? If they can get a 4, they will have already done more than Zealot did. But Zealot, remember, they do have enough gems, I believe so, for another turn themselves after this is done. Tychus, nice dodge on Chromie there, beginning to siege down this Webweaver. The slowing sands in an immensely annoying position.
Oh, I didn't know who Ethereal Angel was going for. Nasty! Yeah. We'll just
dead.
Die.
No way out. Beautiful play by Dehaka there. And that is the second kill, and quite a few gems lost, actually. Lorba focused out as well, take it out, and wow, Zealots. Second a team fight happens, just absolute brutality, and this push is basically done.
That's what happens when you sneak in a turn in, as you lose someone mid or top. No fort damage, no potion, there's no variant. And the towers didn't exactly Okay, the towers finally fall, but yeah, that's and they used all those resources to save Lauber, if you remember. That was a no wailing arrow teamfight, which makes Sylvanas a glorified archer.
Yeah, just didn't get any value here. And also, I'd like to point out, top towers actually lived, so they didn't even get as much value as Zealots did on their turn in. So, gems-wise, both teams have enough for a turn in. Lauber for now denying Dehaka, who has 35 gems. Luv just out of range. Take a little step forward there, dude. You would have got it. Nasty, though. Had to back up. He wasn't there to try and poke it down because he took a lot of damage.
The blues paid. They're going to get the Web Weavers, and there's still half a level to be bridged for DNC. They could be in trouble here. This could be where Team Zealots super accelerates this game to take it into overdrive and get a 2-3 forts here. Let's see how good the wave clear comp for DNC is to actually try and stem the flow of structural damage.
Yeah, Falstead already has bot lane pushed up very nicely, and he's been using that once again to stack that seasoned marksman. Chromie tried to poke down ETC, but he was already repositioned it to safety. Now Webweaver getting cleared out by Taluf pretty nicely. Doesn't get the drain, but there's no minions right now to help it. They're only just arriving. So the focus has been changed onto mid lane, where there is actually a minion wave to help out.
Did Chromie complete her quest?
Yes, she did.
I feel like she just completed it, so she's got 5% ability power. Let's see if it'll be enough. Cotton.
Yeah. Little bit extra ability power here. Webweaver in the mid lane, still alive. Odin has been popped. That's forcing a bit of a retreat, especially seeing as Taluk is currently not here and just got demounted. He literally just mounted and then got demounted by a range spider just poking him down. Chromie wiping out that Webweaver. It is gone. Top lane, only one that is left, but that's 2-4.
ETC forts. And Tomb. There's crushing hope landed.
And God.
See ya!
Yeah, nicely done. The stage dive's used. Long cooldown, 70 seconds now. But got him out of there, so great success.
Oh, mistake here by DNC. They start rotating up. I mean, is it a mistake? I guess they need to react to this Webweaver. But they sent too many people up there. And guess what? Team Zealous is still here with four. They absolutely had the potential to come here and defend. Mighty Gust comes out. Taluf.
Hardened Bones, eventually, wasn't available. 5 seconds until it was available, and as such, he's picked off and taken down here. Nice kill there by Team Zealots, who have suddenly just taken control of this match after what looked like a really good start for Team DNC.
44 gems on Taluf, Thatcher. That is very painful to lose at this point.
Gone.
Yep.
42 gems in total. He had his entire team's gem count, basically, doubled.
Yeah.
So... not good overall. 62 gems available for Team Zealots. They have enough for another turn in if they could get everyone to turn in. That's what they're trying to do here, sneaking them in bit by bit.
Now, I was willing to consider that maybe we weren't catching anything, but I really feel like DNC outdrafted themselves a little bit with the Chromie pick. It got some early kills, and you know, it's cool, but there's just not enough sustained ranged assassin damage here to deal with the kind of control that Team Zealots has. Yeah. We've got double warrior adaptation, Mighty Gust.
Yeah, I wish they'd gone for someone with seasoned. Just someone with infinite stacking.
Yeah.
Like, even Rainer. I'd take Rainer here.
Yeah.
Get the giant killer, you get the seasoned marks, but it would be beautiful. Stage dive on today. Gets out again. He's immune to that.
I feel like we have a case of slight overestimation of Sylvanas here. She doesn't have the full team fight ability. She'll get stronger though at level 16. Once she gets Cold Embrace, we could see a bit more bursting here.
Yeah, very true. Shifting Sands available for Chromie, as she is, of course, a talent ahead. Two levels in advance. Good damage there. Getting a lovely little bit of poke potential. Missing out on the second Q though. Athero very far forward, but separated from his team. So even if he gets locked down, his team won't die. Shad though, getting Chromied absolutely nicely.
But that's the problem, isn't it? You get all these nice Chromie damages. Who's there to finish it? There's no Zeratul, there's no melee assassin. You get that poke, and then what? You get the Blinding Glare, Crushing Hope, the Lost Dagger from Sylvanas. Anyway, let's see how they can mount a defense here. They keep us under assault. DNC is starting to do an aggressive defense. Starting to move forward. Will we see an Entomb attempt here?
It does not look like it at the moment. Webweaver does go down. Keep at half health. And Zella's still here. Nice poke onto a Thera Angel. Nasty from over the wall there. Wants to get repositioned himself. He does have Reaching Through Time, the extra 15% range on his Q and W. So he's able to snipe from even further away, which is how he was able to get that shot. He was also trying to get Falstad there, who may have been rotating back after trying to catch Chromie in that bottom lane.
small Webweaver health pools still do so much. It's not about bringing them to 90%, you really do need to kill them. It always impresses me. Look at that. The whole wall goes down. And that's pretty much what Zealots came for. And they're just pulling them apart. The Haka top solo, before it was fast at bot solo. We have the whole team rotating here, in vain most likely.
Yeah, just slight, just the globals, even on such a small map, getting immense amounts of value out of Team Zealots. And now, they're moving back towards even more turn-ins by the looks of it. They're nowhere near enough for a full turn-in. But they're in a good position to build themselves towards it. They have really good map control, but the five-man rotation is still coming out of Team DNC, and right now they are on even talents.
Okay, let's see what they got. They got Unyielding Despair, more Drain Hopes. We've got Cold Embrace, the Vulnerability, Shifting Sands, Entangling Tenacious Roots, and Imposing Presence. So we see a bit more of that purple swirl coming out from Labra, reducing people's attack speeds.
But right now, getting focused a little bit, taking a lot of damage, blinds Tychus very quickly, but wade through the damage, taking a lot thanks to that lead ray. No, not lead ray, sorry, it was on pitch ground stage. Down he goes! In comes the Entomb, but it doesn't matter, he just charges through it. Gust catches everyone except Talupa, who was still in Wraithwalk. He's now separated from his team. He goes down, as does Artie eventually. Nasty being chased in the distance, attempting to escape his fate, but he gets stunned. Only a living member is Marching Nehi, who has escaped death so many times, but one more is not on the cards. He goes down, full team wipe.
And let me just tell you how harrowing that fight was for DNC. Wailing Arrow, Blessed Shield, didn't get used. That's how fast they got bursted. That's how much control Team Zealots exercised here. Of course, it all started with that Tychus move on Johanna. He was overkilling from here all the way to here, Johanna. With the grenade, Poyok doing massive damage, and then that stage dive finish off. Easy as ABC 1-2-3, and now with the boss, level 19.8, once they get that tower, they're pretty much level 20. Hello.
Taloof.
Double walls!
You will not pass, wall. Taloof re-ghosted. Chromie is now once again in control of the D-push, trying to work that down as much as possible. One more level, like we said, is he can get her level 20 talent, basically, which comes to level 18 for her. But the game might end before that at this rate. Hey, Bolstad!
No bye-bye, no bye-bye, no ice block.
Yeah, Chromie, take it out. The Auric will be back soon, but it might not be enough. Nehi, once again in full retreat, makes his way into his base, he survives, but what can he do? Everyone's at full health here. This is going to be GG and Zealots taking game number two, and they will move on to the quarterfinals.
Yeah, very well played here by Zealots. Going to the quarterfinals, 2-0 victory. DNC showed a lot of sign of life and promise in the first game. In the second game, not as much. Perhaps crippled by a draft that did not go maybe as they wanted to or as they should have wanted to. Well played by Zealots here, though.
Yeah, it was a super cool game, but we both seem to disagree. We both slightly disagree with them on that choice. Like anyone who had the potential to scout the late game, because their comp led to it so much.
Yeah. If it wasn't Lunara, you mentioned maybe.
I mentioned Rainer.
Rainer. I'm just gonna go through the roster here, search for some assassins. When we talk about late game heroes, we talk about heroes that have actually more damage scaling per level, like Lunara's Poison, 4.5% per level instead of 4%, what most heroes have. And heroes that, due to certain talent spikes or quest collection talents, get better late game, like Tetcher saying with Rainer and Seasoned Marksman.
Would have been cool, but
Butcher, but he doesn't fit.
Yeah, he would have been might have had a little bit of trouble there. Would have bested left Sylvanas as the only range damage.
That's pretty much it. Rainer, Lunara,
Butcher. But it's too risky.
They could have gone Zagara and embraced the full wave clearing delicacy that they were trying to serve here on a dish to Team Zealots, and they would have had more vision as well with the creep. And actually, Zagara got buffed in the recent patch.
She has serrated spines. Technically an ability that if you can auto-attack consistently in the late game, you will get a crazy amount of damage, but I've never seen that get value.
And she has the hardest quest in the game, the Roach Bot drop, 20 hits with Roach Links, direct impact damage, but she also has Devouring Maul, which would be pretty decent in this game, Creep. I was actually going to say it, that maybe Zagara should be picked there, but that's pretty much the three options that I think would have been good. Lunara, Rainer, and Zagara. It was Grubby. Yeah. Either way, maybe it was good anyway, you know? We're just the casters, they are the aspiring pro players. Maybe it was just too high level by Zealots.
Positioning himself, they want to try and catch someone, but look at this. There's no reason for Boar to get caught out of position. They can just take the long route. Krolu dropping the bribe zone. That basically forces the fight, and that's actually really good for them. The Flesh Shield's good though. Mighty Gas pushing Fibly so far away here. Apoc landing here. Nuti is so low, he's running away. He's able to keep himself. He's finally killed off there. But overall, it's a 1-0. But down goes Dahaka. Diablo completely rooted out of position as well. Now it's kind of down to Shibley and Sturgeon to try and do any kind of damage to the backline. Heading, taking a lot of damage. The Seeker does not hit. The Ice Block will, though. That is very nice. And